bridge between village potters and urban consumers with no experience, no business plan, but with confidence in her instincts. Anita moved on to a Good Earth, set up Good Earth in Kemp's Corner, Mumbai. Over two decades, Good Earth has grown into a brand that is recognized as a pioneer of style and of contemporary design, filtered through an Indian prism. Her commitment to supporting artisan communities comes from an appreciation of making by hand, of crafts as a wellspring of Indian creativity.
Share your words.
Her philosophy of sustainable luxury is rooted in a strongly held belief that both the environment, our society, and our lives can benefit in a meaningful and relevant way through the revival of handcrafts and our ancient Indian wellness traditions. Anita is a storyteller, and you can see that across every aspect of Good Earth, from the design collections, the retail experience, the fragrances, to the music. Welcome, Anita.
Thank you.
Then I have David. David Abraham again needs no introduction. He is the creative director of Abraham and Thakur, a graduate of NID. His interests lie in exploring contemporary expressions of traditional Indian craft and in developing a design vocabulary that is diverse yet restrained. His practice is closely concerned with the role of identity in fashion, particularly in contemporary India. Abraham and Thakur's collections are retailed in India and overseas. Their designs have been acquired by the Victoria and Albert Museum in London for their permanent archives and have been displayed in multiple exhibitions on contemporary Indian designs around the world. David is a writer, and he writes a very interesting bi-monthly column that I follow in The Voice of Fashion on fashion, culture, and identity. This 1 hour that we have ahead of us is not going to be your presentations and or reading papers. These are people who live and breathe their work. And from their very life, you can take out words, restrain, India, culture, creativity, high aesthetics, delving in traditions. And I just want to add, sorry, I'm going to favor Anita a little bit over you, because just 3 weeks ago, I attended one of the most incredible programs, and I say it was one of the finest programs I saw. I don't know how many of you were there, but to my eye, to my mind, that program that she called Sindhu, it traced truly the wellsprings of our creativity, our culture, and our hand skills, and the intermingling of syncretism and everything this country stands for. And she brought it forward, lifting up craft, and every craftsperson, by the way, who worked on even a stitch was physically present at that show, along with, I think, the cognoscenti of the city and from all over India. So I want to start with Anita and with Sindhu.
Okay.
So over to you.
Oh, just like that.
Just like that.
So really, I don't know how it will relate to the topic we have. But if the topic is about pehchan, and Sindhu was a culmination of, again, the very fact that for me, what excites me or what gives me the greatest delight is to delve into our heritage. And I mean, I'm so proud of the fact that we come from an unbroken civilization. And you know, when I researched Sindhu, I found that we all do know that the river Indus is the one I'm talking about. It was known as Sindhu. It was a Sanskrit word. Sindhu means a large water body. And there was no such place as India or anything else. We were just, you know, inhabitants of this continent, subcontinent. And And you know, Sindhu, when I looked at it, it's the cradle of what we call the Indus Valley civilization, which was, as we know, such an advanced way of living that they did then. And when I was researching, I found that actually Banaras existed even at that time. We don't know these things. They were, with the Indus Valley people were actually, they had trade going on with Banaras as well, and all kinds of things like that. So for me, I wanted to actually celebrate, I would say, this ancient heritage, which I call the undivided past. They are the threads that bind us with what has sadly now become Pakistan, but really it's the same people, it's the same culture, it's the same roots, it's where we've all come from. And so Sindhu was about, and also about the people. I mean, we owe everything we have today to the people who have innovated, who have discovered, who have created technology. After all, weaving of cloth, of fabric, of cotton, actually, what we talk about cotton, but the Indus Valley people is where they learned how to grow cotton, how to, weave it, and also decorate it. And from what my research tells me, that ajrak was something they were even doing way back then, and which broken and however it went, and the nomads took it everywhere, but that tradition continues, and so many traditions today continue from those times. So Sindhu was a tribute to our ancestors and our cultural roots, and that's what I tried to create.
Thank you. Before I ask David a question, Anita asked a question. She said, I don't know what I did at Sindhu has to do with Himru. And I'm sorry, yeah. I should have said it. I got very excited having both of you here. But what it has to do with Himru is that when I started looking at miniatures to see where can I see the Himru, because if it is a 12th, 13th, 14th century tradition, it should be visible to me in miniature paintings. After all, it was woven and worn by Muhammad bin Tughlaq, or Shah Jahan wore it in his later years, as did Aurangzeb. And when I started looking at it, it was such a subdued, elegant pattern. It required pehchan. It did not glitter with gold and luxury. Yes, they did wear baubles that were the size of pigeon eggs. You know, the jewelry just spilled over. But it was such a beautiful, quiet luxury. Underneath all that incredible emeralds and diamonds and pearls was this quiet fabric. Only someone who knew would say that is why a badshah is wearing this textile. So this is really about quiet luxury. This is about pehchan. This is about slow making. And that is what both of you represent. Not bling, not anything, but
it's
slow,
really,
quiet.
It's really bucking the tide,
yeah,
let me tell
is.
You. Because bling is the is the fashion of today. let's face it, yeah.
So David, I come to
David
you.
Tell us.
You have written that you do restrained fashion. And we see that in the way you dress, in the way you conduct your life, and in all the textiles that you've done, including the fact that while you're in the Victoria and Albert permanent collection, you take part in the Fashion Week, you have one quiet store. Tell us about restraint. Tell us what has kept you on this path. And as Anita said, it is about bling. What has stopped you from getting into bling? Because at the end of the day, it is custom, it is monetary, you have to pay salaries. So tell us about your quiet luxury and pehchan.
Hello, everybody. That's a very difficult question, actually. But I think there's a combination of two things. One is, of course, the work of a designer or a design company like ours reflects the work, the philosophy of the founders. So in a sense, what we do is an articulation of our beliefs. And we're very material-led. I think that's been our training. And I think when you work very closely with material and you respect the material, you don't really need to do that much to draw attention to it. There are many, many subtle ways of doing it. But then having to come to the second point about bling and about that is a very obvious language, and there are a lot of consumers and there are a lot of people who want symbols that are very easy to decipher, and they will get that. But then there are also enough people, I think, who do understand. And I think that even though the numbers of the, let's call them the bling lovers, are very large, or the over-articulated in terms of design are very large, I think that the quieter consumer also very much exists, because I don't think Anita would be sitting here and expanding store after store if she didn't have those customers. They're growing. 20 years ago, they were less, Anita. I mean, look at the number of stores you have and the number of people who are you consuming Godot. No, but and I have survived business for 25 yeah. years. Yeah. So, I mean, the fact that we're still sitting here and not on the street is a fact that there are people who do buy this. They're not always going to be as, but I think that maybe brings us then to the subject that we are talking about, which is the handmade, about luxury, exactly, fechar and luxury.
I think the key is, David, how do you, or we, all of us, I think everyone I speak for, people who are in this place today, how do you convey that? See, because in the end, you want to convert people also,
of
because
course.
you want people to appreciate, as I said, our heritage. And what greater heritage do we have today than the textile heritage that we talk about? Now, how many people do we think are actually appreciating that and will buy a quiet thing because it's got the hand? I'm not sure, and I think that is a question we must ask ourselves. How does one... So with Sindhu, what I did try and do was, it didn't have bling, so to speak, as you know. But it had, of course, decorations, it had embroideries. That's also part of our culture, our heritage to embellish. So it's not that we don't want embellishment, it is how the embellishment is done. I think that was the question, and in Sindhu we did address that. And I think in the end it is this, you create some shows, you create a little, the buzz, the people. A lot of people then start looking at, you know. But it's not easy.
It's not easy. But I think, you know, it's something that we all have to, I mean, even a seminar like this, and I think the more people one reaches out to, and I think that the more we talk about how invaluable this textile heritage is, I mean, using Himru as one example, but I think it applies to all textile craft. Mm-hmm. I mean, all craft, we'll be talking textiles here today. Because we are the last resource in the world for a multitude of skills that cannot be duplicated in any economy. We are really going to shoot ourselves in the head if we don't recognize it and actually privilege this within our entire ecosystem. That's one. Two, we have to be able to recognize that craft and the handmade is luxury. It's not inexpensive. I mean, there's been, for the first 50 years post-independence, when we were driving craft towards the lower end of the market, which is unsustainable, because we need, if we're going to value our craftspeople, they have to get the wages that they would get in an IT industry. We have to pay for these saris or these textiles. We don't need to be Muse the fabric for fashion and for garments. And those skills, you need to move up to that. I think that's exactly what we both share, that belief. Mm-hmm. We are aiming at that customer, and that customer must pay for it. So that becomes very important. And I think that if we recognize that the handmade is the real luxury. Luxury is not a polyurethane handbag that's been made in China with a designer logo on it, which is the largest selling handbag right now in the world. But that is polyurethane, and it's industrially produced in a material that's made in China and then assembled in another country. Now, but that is really a matter of perception. All we're really talking about is perception. How does one change people's perception? How do we create value?
I think that's the challenge.
Yeah, that is the challenge, your perception.
How do we make people realize? But do you think people will only realize it if... I mean, we've got the most exquisite Jamdani saris in Paro, created by this craftsperson. It's in cotton, from Bengal. I think it takes them, 6-8 months to create one of those saris. When you wear them, you feel you're wearing air. It's beyond beautiful. Mm. But my daughter bought them, I bought them, a few other friends bought them, that's it.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody else comes and looks at them. They are, of course, about 1,80,000 or something.
But people spend
beyond beautiful, and when you wear it, it's... But how do we convey this?
People spend 2-3 lakhs on a handbag.
I know. But they won't do it on a most exquisite fine cotton hand woven jumper.
And the good thing is, in a way, that I hear this.
We have to talk about the problems. Yeah, I mean, not
exactly.
Just, you know,
is that the West is turning to India. They are turning because they are tired of buying products that they don't know where they were produced. They want a khadi. They want to know who the weaver is who made the product.
Yeah.
They are changing. They have had enough of polyurethane.
Talking about conscious consumption.
Yeah, exactly. And hopefully it is going to filter in.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Yeah, I think it is stalwarts around both of you and many others who are working to change this perception very, very hard. Because you see, when you go to a mela and they say, ye kharab hai kyunki ye handmade hai. There is that perception also, that if it's handmade, thoda sa to problem hoga. And that is what is being changed. That is being changed by people like you all to say, yes, it is handmade, but look at the perfection of the hand. And this is sustainable, and give respect to the maker. And, you know, I know it's hard.
Yeah, but it is, these are questions I think we should talk with
it's
everyone on the floor,
and there are
not
so
just
many
David
people,
and I.
Yeah.
I think everyone here
this session is about asking questions.
How, the question I would say is, how do we
tell us.
How do we make people understand?
I think Taji and David raised a very, very valuable question. What is the challenge? But I think as a nation, as a country, we have to do a lot of work. We cannot be totally dependent, the West will come and find, because we have to educate our own people, our own young generation.
Yeah.
What have we created? What is our legacy? What is our heritage? We have to have better quality of museums, we have to have better exchange of dialogue, we have to have symposiums, we have to have people to bring, we have to show our textiles, what have we created, what are we going to do, how do we get inspired? Young people, how I got inspired here, these are the gurus sitting here, these are the ladies' legends, but how many others are there? What is the platform?
It's such a valid point, because like when you go to Japan, everybody is aware, their museums are so beautiful, they value each prefecture will have its own things, and they go, they look at fine crafts, pottery, textiles, which of course we are completely lacking.
Well, I think, you know, to put it in a quite a crude way, I think a lot of it is also due to the success of marketing. If you have a very, very good marketing machine, like to create the desire for people to spend 2 lakhs on a synthetic branded handbag with the name, because you're paying 2 lakhs to advertise somebody else's company. So if you've gone to the next level, you're not just buying a bag for your utility purposes, you're buying it and you're advertising that company.
Yeah.
Now that is marketing. And if we had the resources, if we had the intelligence, and if we did it at a national level for a lot of craft, I mean, and for a lot of the things that we make, it would happen.
Yeah.
And I think that we're beginning to become very aware of it now. I think a path has begun.
David, I think very good question. I'm just going to add to this, that all the so-called luxury brands have one thing in common, which we would have to do also, which is high quality.
Yeah.
Which is impeccable quality. Without that, you cannot put a luxury tag, whether it's, I mean, an impeccable can have imperfections, that's not the question.
Yeah.
But impeccable is in how it's been done and conceived, etc. So I think the quality, because then we have the same, you know, people are making kani shawls of every quality.
Very
how
well
do we
said.
Say yours is the, which it is, yours is the most beautiful, luxurious one. But how do you differentiate?
As David said very well, you know, it is the branding, which best had the art of branding, marketing, and this. We are getting there, so it will take us.
And also, you know, in the craft system, you know, when we shortchange the manufacturer, and we are trying to get saris made for, to sell in a hearth for like 500, 600 rupees, where is the money to buy yarn? Where, what kind of dyes are they going to use?
Actually,
what kind of quality? It's a vicious circle. We're feeding
this,
you know.
It's tragic. Yeah, it's
Hemendra
tragic.
Hemendra has a question. Hemendra was working with Women's Weave, where he trained a lot of people in the handloom school, and now has set up
this is
something.
Women's Weave.
So Hemendra, tell us about your experience.
Namaste. मैं पिछले 10 साल से हैंडलूम में काम कर रहा हूँ. तो मुझे जैसे कई वजह से अभी आपने कहा कि लोग मतलब कैसे ये आगे बढ़ेगा. मैंने देखा है कि बहुत ज़्यादा पता नहीं चल रहा, पर जैसे आप पिछले 20-25 साल से काम कर रहे हैं और आप कह रहे हैं सस्टेन हो रहे हैं कि कुछ लोग हैं जो कि खरीद रहे हैं आपसे या आप जैसे लोगों से इंस्पायर होकर, और जो नए बच्चे पढ़कर निकल रहे हैं वो अपना छोटा ब्रांड कहीं छोटे शहर में शुरू कर रहे हैं और वो कर रहे हैं, उनकी एक स्पेसिफिक रीच है. हो सकता है वो जो रीच उनकी है वो लोग आपके पास नहीं आते हों खरीदने, पर वो वैसी चीज़ लेना चाहते हैं और वो जो नए लोग हैं वो उनको दे रहे हैं. तो हमने मतलब इतने 10-12 साल में देखा है कि अभी ऐसा ट्रेंड तो नहीं आया कि हम कहें कि हैंडमेड के लिए डिमांड नहीं बढ़ रही. बढ़ रही, स्केल में बढ़ रही है, विजिबल नहीं हो सकती है शायद, क्योंकि वो सारा इंफॉर्मेशन कलेक्ट नहीं हो पा रहा. जैसे कि 10 साल हमने वुमेन वीव में काम किया, फिर 2016 में कला स्वराज फाउंडेशन इस्टेब्लिश किया, एंड सौंसर जो नागपुर का एरिया है जहाँ कॉटन वीव होता था उस कॉटन को रिवाइव किया, मलमल कॉटन. टुडे वी वर्क लाइक मोर देन 100 वीवर्स, रेगुलर एम्प्लॉयमेंट, एंड लाइक वीविंग 5000 मीटर्स पर मंथ एंड वर्किंग विद द मेनी ब्रांड्स इन इंडिया एज वेल एज इस्टेब्लिश ब्रांड इन यूके एंड अदर प्लेसेस, एंड दे आर लविंग दैट फैब्रिक. सो अच्छा हो रहा है, मेरे ख्याल से वो अच्छा बहुत ज़्यादा दिख नहीं रहा है.
I mean, this is really so. I mean, this is really the. I mean, this is a fantastic.
Actually, this is the
riposte, you know, the general thing. It is. This is the future.
Yeah.
And what I can just add to it is, as exactly as you were saying, Asif, that branding is now what we need to focus on. So there is an awareness that what the work you are doing and the work that all the other cooperatives are doing is now being talked about and being made visible somehow in the marketplace and to the consumer.
Yeah, I definitely think that stores that are out there for the public to buy stuff, whether it is more than most of us can afford or a little less than that, or things like Malkha or Women's Weave, or even to the extent of the Dastakar Niche Bazaar that has started, it's not cheap. Where we go, all of us.
Yeah.
Now, you may argue that some of it is not perfect and it is not also commanding the best kind of rate. However, I have to tell you that I take my staff and go to Dastakar every year when I can. Nothing there is affordable to them. Nothing. They recognize a lot of stuff because it's in my house. But this is the only way to go. We have to. This kind of thing is very good for all of us to get inspired and to motivate ourselves to do more, but this is really feeding the Fed. This kind of thing, you know. It's not that it's not required, but I really think marketing, and to lead that marketing, why I'm asking questions, since you are successful business houses, why is it that you do not invest enough in the branding of these things? You know, you have to brand them. You have to put these people who people respect, publicity, they pick up. Whatever. Put them into these clothes. Why are they being used for other things? Why not for this? The film stars. It's money, right? So somebody has to fund this thing. Now, obviously, there are not enough of you kind of people to get a consortium or for some big person to think it's worthwhile to brand or to package or to sell.
Just to tell you that traditionally, Indians have never believed in all this. So our style was very different.
I agree.
We based it on pehchan. The very thing that we started this topic on was because it came, of course, from up down, let's say from royalty to nobility to the others. And the pehchan came because all of us know our mothers bought Banarsi saris and they valued them. And there was a pehchan that it's a thing, and there were no branding, nothing. The West were the kings of branding,
Okay, I want to just add something. It may not sound right, but this coming from my heart is what I believe. My mother also taught me pehchan, which is why I have it. But we are not just a few elite people buying things anymore. And if you want to mass market this or make it bigger than it is, then we need everybody.
But then again, we are talking, are we going to do mass market or
no,
not?
No, mass means what? Extend it.
That's a very important
extend
question.
The market. Extend it. To extend, we have to teach the pehchan. to teach the pehchan, you have to first push something in somebody's face. It's not like growing up every day and seeing those beautiful things in your homes, right?
Sure.
People have not grown up seeing them. In fact, I am really worried about what people are growing up and seeing today.
Sure.
So I think that some of us have a, if we are seeing it and we think it's necessary, we have a responsibility to put these things out there so people see them rather than whatever we're talking about, other than those bags.
I would add on that. I think we are in the process of that. Okay, you have to understand that when David will be knowing that 25 years before when I first started, I'm learning, went to Paris in Maison Objet, they were one Indian company. Today we have Indian brands showing the collections. We are in the process of it. We are doing it. Our young generation is going abroad. They are getting educated. They are coming back. They are putting their
That's
talent.
True.
Yeah. So this is a process.
And
it is not going to happen
Indian
so
designers.
Quick. Therefore, as a nation, it is not one person's responsibility. We are small houses. We are not Louis Vuittons of the world, or we don't have that kind of, which they have built it, they have that kind of markup.
They have international
People,
markets.
We
know.
Also have to understand how to respect our own culture and heritage and our own artists. That is the more awareness we need also. So therefore, this is a challenge. It is happening. It will happen where the advertising is coming, all that branding, it will happen. But it's, I think, my opinion that we are in the process of it.
I think that also I agree with you that it is actually growing. I don't think it's restricted to the people who sit in the room
this.
Of
course not.
Because I look at the, for example, the fashion industry. I mean, I've been taking part in FDCI for the past X number of years. And every season, even though everyone says, oh, that's very, very small, you see about 10, 15 new designers coming up working with beautiful handloom fabric, which didn't happen when I started.
Absolutely.
And they all have customers. They're all in business. They're not bankrupt. It's small, but it's definitely growing. Also, what needs to be understood is the context of the product, because you cannot also keep designing the same product that our parents wore. The weaver of somebody who's doing, say, for example, a sari has to also consider how he weaves fabric that can be made into clothing, into ready-made clothing, so to extend the market. So it has to be dealt with at two levels, and I think it is. It's happening, but as he says, in a slow, fairly organic fashion, maybe it'll pick up speed later.
Just a thought, that could there be a portal which could be like luxury from India or something like that, under which all the brands are there, whoever is there, and you can get a direct link to those brands. So which
you're saying,
you know,
a consortium?
It's a it's a portal which you're not, they're not selling, but they can link under one this thing. There could be
मैं नसीम अहमद फ्रॉम बनारस आर्ट मैं वीविंग के काम करता हूं तो मेरा सवाल ये था कि जैसा कि ऋतु जी ने कहा कि लोगों की धारणा है कि जो हाथ से बना है वो अच्छा नहीं तो मैं पूछता हूं कि जो लोग जब म्यूज़ियम में जाते हैं तो वही हाथ से बनी हुई चीज़ जब देखते हैं तो उनका मोहित हो जाते हैं देखकर क्योंकि कि जब नवाब थे राजा थे तो उस टाइम में वो कारीगरों को बुला के उनसे काम लेते थे और बेहतरीन काम उनसे करवाते थे क्योंकि वो स्किल्ड थे दक्ष थे तो आज हमको अच्छा चाहिए लग्जरियस चाहिए लेकिन लोग पैसा खर्च कर रहे हैं तो वो वीवर कैसे हम दक्ष बनाएंगे पहले परंपरा ये थी कि गुरु शिष्य परंपरा का वो चलन था तो गुरु थे वो लोगों को सिखाते थे और माँ बाप अपने बच्चों को भेजते थे कि जाओ अच्छा काम सीखो 5 साल 10 साल मेरे दादाजी लिखाई का काम करते थे डिज़ाइनिंग का 27 साल काम किया उन्होंने और 2-3 साल उन्होंने नक्शेबंदी सीखा 30 साल में उन्होंने निपुण हो गए तो उसके बाद जब वो कोई काम करता है कोई भी वीवर इतना टाइम गुजार देगा डिज़ाइनर तो हो सकता है कि जब वो काम करेगा तो बिल्कुल परफेक्ट होगा मेरे प्राइम मिनिस्टर साहब कहते हैं कि जीरो इफेक्ट जीरो डिफेक्ट तो मैं कहता हूँ कि जब मशीन इतना अच्छा काम कर रही है और लोगों को अट्रैक्ट कर रही है और चीप एंड बेस्ट है तो लोग वो ख़रीद भी रहे हैं, तो एक तरफ तो अच्छा चाहिए, सस्ता चाहिए और अपनी पहचान, आप पहचान से जुड़े हैं तो हमारी पहचान बचेगी कैसे, इसके लिए क्या प्रावधान हो रहा है, लोग कितने जागरूक हैं, और हम अगर तरक्की कर रहे हैं तो अपनी पहचान को कुचलते हुए तरक्की ना करें, क्योंकि हमारी पहचान ही सब कुछ है। और अगर कला बच गई, कलाकार मर गया, तो मुझे लगता है कि अकलमंदी नहीं है।
सही, बिल्कुल सही है। इनफैक्ट आई डू वांट टू ऐड हियर वन पर्सन हु कम्स टू माइंड कि जिन्होंने बहुत बढ़िया काम किया है, जो आज यहाँ है नहीं है, हिज नेम इज संजय गर्ग। रॉ मैंगो हैज मैनेज टू ब्रिंग द ट्रेडिशनल साड़ी बैक इन टू फैशन। ही इज द किंग ऑफ मार्केटिंग, ही इज द किंग ऑफ पोजिशनिंग, ही हैज ग्रेट एस्थेटिक and he has a great understanding. He is a man who comes from the roots. I tell him he is the most rooted person. All of us have learned a lot of things, and I was more anglicized as when we were growing up. He really comes and he understands, but he has that great understanding. So aise kaam aapko aap pata hoga aapko raw mango ka, तो उन्होंने किया है। उन्होंने देखो आज इंडियन सारी फिल्म स्टार्स ये वो सब पहन रहे हैं और ट्रेडिशनल कपड़े पहन रहे हैं, ट्रेडिशनल किए हैं। सो आई थिंक वी मस्ट ऑल्सो सेलिब्रेट द सक्सेसेस ऑफ पीपल हु हैव एक्चुअली मैनेज्ड टू यू नो सो व्हाट हैज ही डन, ही हैज गॉट आवर ट्रेडिशन, ही हैज गॉट वीमेन टू फाइनली कम बैक इनटू द साड़ीज। सो आई ही इज अ ग्रेट, ही इज अ पर्सन आई ग्रेटली एडमायर।
यू नो मार्केटिंग, इट्स बीन
मार्केटिंग, ही इज द किंग,
ही
इज द ट्रायम्फ। वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट मार्केटिंग, वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट पोजीशनिंग, नन ऑफ अस हैव बीन एबल टू डू it the way he has done it. So I think that's a person to at least admire and acknowledge what he has done.
Yeah,
there should be a lot more like him. Because marketing is the key.
Marketing is key.
Positioning is the key.
I think we can agree luxury is relative.
Yeah.
So yes. For someone, Raw Mango may not be even a luxury brand. For some, it may be the most luxurious brand. But you know, India has shown success in hospitality. We have 7-star hospitality in the country.
Sure.
We have shown it in other fields. We have among the best airports in the world. What ails, I mean, it's not that India has not produced international brands of repute. If you look at what Asha did with Issey Miyake, you know, 40 years back, if you look at Shah Mahuja, which was the most coveted floor covering, you know, at some point in the world. So it's not that the textile or fashion field in India has not produced that.
No, it's the marketing.
So what is, so is it only marketing that ails our ability to reach?
It's the best and then to market.
So is it only marketing
that
ails us? And if not, what are some of the other factors? Surely it can't be an excuse that India, which can produce the best wellness spas in the world, the best hotels, cannot produce one international fashion or textile brand today. And it is not that, you know, brands like Bodies or Rahul Mishra, who now shows at Fashion Week, or Manish Arora have not gone international. But other than marketing, surely there have to be some other brass tacks or some other devices which have prevented us from actually telling all of these stories to the world. I mean, why is today Himru not a fabric that a Zenia is using? Why is it not 1 lakh rupees a meter, you know? So there must be something other than marketing.
Let's talk about it.
Yeah.
Long time ago, I was taken by Jeannie to Paris my first time, and I went to Ritz Hotel. If you walk in Ritz Hotel, there's a huge corridor. Right and left are small windows. All these windows represent the brands.
Mm.
Okay? To give you the example that the countries which have done a successful marketing, along with it, they have done other works on the ground, which is to build the best design schools, which is to build the best museums, which is to build the best galleries, which is to give their hotels, the 5-star hotels, the other. It is a mandatory that you have to show local brands, local things. What we have to do, a collective thing, it is not only the brand. There are a lot of things need to be done in this country. Do we go today, a brand like me, David, or like David, we cannot afford Oberoi. We cannot afford any other. Except the Taj, if you see, no hotel gives the real craft, jo Indian craft, a space. So there is a lot of things which we can do, which our people, our industries, our cooperatives, our ministry, it's not about you give the subsidies, grants and this. No. Look at the craft museum. Look at the national museum. You had a fantastic exhibition of Rahul Jain's and Lekha.
Yes.
I was crying. I thought if this would be anywhere in the world, people will be like, you know, queuing. Anita Ji did a fashion show. It was fantastic. Okay, secondly, how many people, to give you an example, we went to Vienna, there was a Fabric of Life, Anita Ji, they sponsored it, their things were, there were 25 people from India. Did anybody write it about it? No. You have Santa Fe, you have 300, you have 25 stands of India there. You have 250 artisans from all over the world. Does anybody cover it in India? No. You have MoMA, you have going the stands. Does anybody bother to cover it? No. It is not a campaign only 3, 4, 10, 15 of us will do in our own capacity or people like this. We have to do a collective. It has a government has a responsibility. People have a responsibility. We have to change that mindset. How do we respect it? How do we respect our weaver? It is the artist. You see it happening. Until and unless we do it.
Because I sit in Chanakya and I can see a place like Chanakya should have had the best of Indian brands. What have they done? They've got all the foreign brands. I mean, because their prices are such that the Indian brands can't afford it. But you know, what a shame. And now, by the way, it's a dead place because who was coming to buy one Ralph Lauren dress or one Chanel? Nobody. They just come to eat and drink and go away. So I'm just saying the mindset, we also commercial, nobody really cares for the country, so to speak, or let's say country for the heritage.
Yeah, I
don't talk
we have
country.
No ecosystem.
I even explained it to those guys, but you know, in the end, they want no. But they have a problem. They say NDMC wants their charges are so high.
Yeah.
So they have their reasons also. It's not. But I'm just saying, as you say, if the government also said, China does it. By the way,
yeah.
Go to China. They have. Yeah, the French.
With the French.
The Chinese, by the way,
give
huge infrastructure to artisans, and we've been there and to see. I was seeing ceramics actually. So you know, crockery, handmade. The government gives you these subsidized places, beautiful big buildings where every artist had his own studio. Every artisan. We had a place where all our Himru workers are. You know, special Kani people, if we had a huge complex and they all had subsidized studios, can you imagine what
it
would do?
Start, you know, right at the
These
top.
These are the things we
yeah.
need
I
to
think
think
it's
about.
A governmental thing.
We can't talk.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
you look
it's
at...
Infrastructure is very important.
The ecosystem of the
yeah.
class.
And then people
exactly.
can...
But
I know
also,
we are doing Dastakar,
yeah.
which is also
yeah.
nice, which
yeah.
is at that level.
But, it's not
but when you talk about luxury,
yeah.
then you have
that's
to also
luxury.
Do the other.
But I want to add one really sad thing here. We've been talking government. Just recently, I think about 4 months back or 6 months back, there was a remarkable exhibition in the US on Khadi done by Isemiyake. Why couldn't that exhibition come here? And I'll give you the reason why. If it had been held in India anywhere, Isemiyake would have been arrested. Because the term khadi now is owned by the government of
That's
India.
That's ridiculous.
So
it's ridiculous what
I
they've
want
done.
To ask you millions of our forefathers were jailed for, yeah, but because they didn't get to know. But millions of our, yeah, by the way, not the, it did know.
Like even
Khadi,
Asal is Khadi, but I can't say it's Khadi.
You cannot use the word Khadi.
She's right.
At all. It is, I will not even tell you how many cases there are against people who do even use the word hand,
And woven also they're not
yeah,
allowing.
They're not allowing. And by the way, they're not allowing the word something to do with the tool. And they're cracking down so badly on small producers
yeah.
who are actually making it. So we are actually in an ecosystem that is working against
yeah,
us.
Yeah. And we don't have a unified
yeah.
vision at the,
yeah.
you know, the
yeah.
collective vision
yeah.
which can
to get together
can create
and
this industry.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
it's a bit of both, but they don't, obviously there's no sense
yeah.
of
yeah, technology will maybe help jump that.
I think Italy was a very good example after the Second World War. They really rose from the ashes and created luxury brands.
How did they do it?
Based, government completely supported. They realized that they had to make Made in Italy into a brand which they would sell
like
to the world.
Have to talk to
and
the
they
government.
Started with craft.
They
craft.
They started industrial, completely focused on
it.
I now have to come back to two words. When I started, I spoke about Sindhu, and I mentioned that at that really luxurious, amazing space, Anita had invited every tailor, every printer, every embroiderer. And I come back to that, and I use the word that our crafts, our hand skills will not remain without respect.
Yeah.
That is the only way. And it is always the elephant in the room. But the elephant in every room is our caste system. And our caste system has actually done a lot. I mean, this is not a lesson in history. But the fact is, there is no shoulder to shoulder going on. How many of us can weave, embroider, or stitch? Why is it that we don't know who wove the fabric? We need that. We need to give an equivalence of respect. And when you give respect, because in seminars we bemoan that people are leaving their trade. When you give the respect, people come back. And we have innumerable examples of them doing engineering because their parents said, "Ye kabhi nahi ye karenge," and then coming back. So that is also part of what both of them, I think, are working on sustaining and giving respect. And that was actually part of both their CVs also, sustain, evolved, artisan respect. And I think what we're actually seeing here, I know Anita admires Sanjay's marketing, but I admire both David and Anita because they bring to the table ethics. They bring an ethics that of production, of hand production. And I think that is also needs to be added to the mix, the ethics of hand production, whether it's luxury or non-luxury.
Of course. Was everything. Yeah.
If there are any more, yes, Paula.
Yeah. Just a little note that I think that also that obsession with the changing diminish the respect that
one can have for the fabrics.
In the past, those fantastic fabrics
woven in Italy or in the 13th, 14th century. I mean, they were extremely valuable, and one dress would be then unstitched, restitched in another shape. Mm. I mean, there was a consideration. Of course, they were luxury product, not cheap. And I feel that sometime here, I mean, not only here, everywhere, this obsession with fashion changing, doesn't allow people to consider that what they can get, it's a heritage, it's part of an heritage that after years and years will still be absolutely fantastic to wear and rewear and to...
That is a sign of sustainable luxury, is when you can wear it over and over again.
Absolutely.
And not discard it because it is inherently valuable.
Yes,
inherent.
And I think that this concept should be conveyed.
And yes.
And supported. The other point I wanted to make, the Etro windows in Milano are full of beautifully made machine Fulcari curtains. Exactly the brownish ground, the bright silk orange, green, and I mean the most classical palette that you can think. And in any case, Etro is also famous for having
Paisleys and
the Paisley in all kind of ways. So old patterns will never go out of fashion if one is able to really make them and understand the people, understand the value of the of those.
So, my friend Bandana Tiwari, she is an influencer. She was with Vogue, and after a long time, she decided it wasn't doing anything for her. Her conscience told her that she's got to do talk. She talks a lot about now Gandhi and, you know, fashion. I mean, what is fashion and slow fashion? She's become a great, as you know, crusader for that. And she said just what you're saying, which is she we had done a little show in Maldives, Suneva, and we gave her a beautiful silk crepe jacket and some trousers, which she loved. She wore them on three occasions non-stop, and she posted it to say, I wore this on when I did my TED talk, I wore it when I was at the resort, I wore it when I went to, I think she went to Lagos for a fashion show. And she says, with pride I'm saying that this is what fashion has to be. In fact, we have the opposite. If a woman is seen wearing the same dress twice, everybody starts giving, you know, trolling that person. It should be the opposite. If your clothes are beautiful, why can't you wear them many, many times? And that's what you're saying.
But you know, we're now reaching, and the environmental crisis is so great right now.
So we
actually don't have much of a choice.
Have good stuff and have less.
And I think it's being talked a lot about in the schools, in education now, the young designers.
The education school is a big.
Yeah, that's it. It starts there. And there is a lot of talk about how wasteful fashion can be.
Yeah.
And how we need to start changing the whole system, the whole ecosystem of fashion. So I think the conversation, and you know that now they predict, I don't know the exact number, the value of used clothing, or which they call vintage or whatever, is going to reach, I think, like $20 billion in the US in the year 2025 or whatever, because at the rate it's growing. So people are beginning to recycle it. So the whole concept of this constant change, we may not have the opportunity
to. In India, we always recycled mothers, grandmothers' clothes. Cart ke fir kuch aur bana do.
Yeah.
But now we are following the other.
But
system.
I think we are now hit the particular curve where we won't be able to.
Yeah.
If we want, we can't breathe in Delhi.
I don't think
we can afford to.
Yeah. We have a question there.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's a wonderful discussion. I just want to highlight one point, and this is, of course, a non-luxury. It has to do with pehchan and things like that, and also the survival of various textile traditions. So what I say is may not be valid, you know, in its entirety to all craft and textile traditions. But however, what I do find is that on the one hand, there is a challenge of any textile or embroidery tradition to survive and therefore create a quote-unquote, a mass market. Mass not as in factory, larger market.
Yeah.
Now, what has happened is that you have various kinds of producers who come in. You also have self-help groups that come in. You also have, NGO interventions and so on and so forth. Have various skill levels. And as a result, you do get things, you know, for example, chicken curry. You'll get it at a cheap rate, which you people can afford, you know, 250, 350, whatever, you'll get a chicken curry. But you see the pehchan at one level, you know it is chicken curry. Up to a point, is it all right for it to make a textile tradition or an embroidery tradition go ahead? But on the other hand, my concern is that we are not allowing people to grow into the true pehchan, where there is a devaluation of its beauty, of its aesthetics, and so on and so forth, and where it could lead in the future to a machine-made kind of thing, like, you know, she just mentioned about fulkari being, machine-made in Italy. And that, yes, so you could also
yeah.
have it in
well,
that
I,
way.
I've
that
seen beautiful chicken curry in American stores, and I thought, lovely things from India. Turned around, and where was it made? China.
So you have this scenario.
Chicken curry in China.
Now I feel
straight away.
So I feel that we have a lot of market potential within our own country, where we can allow different niche productions and therefore niche markets to grow. However, my concern is this, that the real true essence of the craft or the textile tradition it is being increasingly eroded and devalued for multiple reasons. One, you do not have patrons, or like we just discussed, this ties in with earlier discussion that has happened, that you know, people need to know. That's one thing, need to know and need to be marketed and educated and so on. So for me, it is a mixture of, you know, both. On the one hand, you have a quote.
There are going to be both. And you know, both have their place.
Yeah.
It's also nice that it's available to a lot more people, as you say. But then one has to pull out from there the finest, so that there's appreciation of that. In a country, we have so many craftspeople. And a lot of them, actually a lot of women, the chicken curry, they depend on their livelihood. So if they make slightly more heavy, mota, it's okay.
Yeah.
They're getting the livelihood. People are buying it at a price. That's fair, very fair. But what you're saying is that as a people, we have to be educating ourselves about knowing the fine one. And then even pottery in Japan, not everything is the highest. There are all kinds, because people's pockets are always varying. But at least there should be an appreciation, and that's the part we're talking about.
Sorry, we have one time for one more question.
Oh, so it's getting over.
For an art like Sri Kala as the Kalamkari, where there is a diminishing pool of, you know, the master drawers, you know, those who imagine and who do the master drawing. So, you know, it has different implications for different. For me, my concern is that are we eroding, instead of, you know, the pool of master imaginators and imagineers, you know, decreasing.
But that's what you said, that we have to have schools, places where people can be.
Somebody gets back from South Africa 50 years later,
yeah.
You have that.
Yeah,
of course.
First, they have to clean up the railways.
And rural people will appreciate
it
more.
Well,
and also, I think in some craft, for example, if it does get restricted, the numbers of craftspeople reduce, and it may just be the way the natural phenomena of history, because we lose your patrons, you know, you can't keep it. It has to be economically. At the end of the day, it has to be economically sustainable.
And
we cannot keep anything alive through a sense of romance. Mm-hmm. You know, it has to be hard reality.
Yes.
So as we draw to an end of the session, I want to know, David, Anita, any last words? Just...
No, I think the ideas that have come to my mind are what Lekha said, or what Asif said, which is that we should more consciously, we all work in our own little worlds, and frankly, you world, and I just go to my work and my computer, actually don't look around also, but I think one should, and I think one should be more conscious and see, can we create platforms, consortiums? Bandana, I will, she wants to, and we will, you know, we will look at seeing how we can put Indian sensitive, I would say the words, restraint we have, like in sensitive, even you can do the most beautiful embroideries, but it's how you do it is the question. And maybe we do need to look, all of us together, if we can have a India portal.
I have one thing to say, that also, you know, there is a lot of conversation, particularly in business. The most commonly used term is scaling up.
Oh, I hate it.
And I think that is something that
I
we have
that
to
word.
Actually, it is not applicable in A, in this
scaling
particular
up.
Area, and B, it may not be the way that businesses have to run.
Yeah.
And if you talk about the Gandhian philosophy, which I agree with and some I don't agree with the others, but there is very much, there's a very strong argument for the opposite of scaling up.
Yes, I think the scaling up is...
Yeah.
It works for certain things, but
it
doesn't work for everything.
No, work for
and you cannot apply it for...
Not for the handling.
And I think, like I said in the beginning, both of you live and breathe it. Anita has a few stores, David has one. They are two. Okay.
David, they pulled up once.
Double. So, I think we all end with our agreement that while we love what is available here, we are attuned to our culture, but we don't, oddly, sadly, have an ecosystem. And that is an ecosystem that spreads across makers, doers, thinkers, writers, business, and that makes the ecosystem of this textile culture. So who knows? perhaps next time we meet, there will be something we will be talking about based on the ideas that have come from this very forum. So I thank you all very much. There was a tea planned, but we are not going to break for tea. And we are going to start the next session. Anyone who wants a cup of tea can just step out quietly and have it. But Anamika ji requested me. She has a son coming from America and she said, I want to be home to receive him.
Okay.
So we are going to start Anamika ji's session.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lovely. Anita, the thing is behind.